Hello there, you're watching All 24 News live from Algiers. I'm your host, Kareem Fazakri, and up next are today's top stories. President Abdelmajid Tebboune values the convening of a high-level conference to support the city of Al-Quds in line of activating the most important decisions of the Arab League summit held in Algeria. Also coming up, Zionist forces brutally killed 14-year-old Palestinian during the storming of Jabriyat neighborhood in the city of Jenin in Palestine. Also ahead, about 35,000 people have been reported dead due to the deadly earthquake that hit southern Turkey and northern Syria. And Polish president says giving fighter jets to Ukraine must be a joint decision, while UN Guterres amplified warnings on Ukraine. Hello again and welcome to the program. First in our topical news, Algerian President Mr. Abdelmajid Tebboune valued the convening of a high-level conference to support the city of Al-Quds in line of activating the most important decisions of the Arab League summit held in Algeria on November 1st. President Tebboune, in his speech read on his behalf by the Algerian Foreign Minister, Mr. Imtala Mamra, expressed Algeria's strong condemnation and absolute rejection of the repeated attempts of the Zionist occupation to impose a fait accompli policy, affirming Algeria's full commitment to supporting the right of the Palestinian people to establish their independent state with Al-Quds as its capital.
Algeria appreciates the positive steps that have been achieved recently, especially at the diplomatic level, and calls for the continuation of efforts as agreed upon at the Algiers summit, especially to adopt and support the State of Palestine's approach to obtain membership in the United Nations. Algeria continues its endeavors aimed at reunification and the promotion of the Palestinian unity as part of the path of reconciliation, which was culminated in the signing of the Palestinian Brothers on the Algiers Declaration, their commitment to work to materialize the rights contained therein.
Algerian head of state also reiterated Algeria's unwavering support to a full Palestinian membership in the United Nations. President Tebboune affirmed Algeria's continued endeavors aimed at reunification and the strengthening of Palestinian national unity. Let's take a listen.
We express our strong condemnation and absolute rejection of the repeated attempts of the Zionist occupation to impose a fait accompli policy that has gone beyond the present to extend to the past by falsifying facts and changing names. In New Algeria, we renew our full commitment to supporting the right of the Palestinian people to establish their independent state on the lines of June 4, 1967, with Al-Quds as its capital.
In his speech at the opening of the Arab League Summit Conference, Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas affirmed that Palestine will continue to defend its right and will face the plans of the more right-wing Zionist government that target Al-Aqsa Mosque. President Abbas revealed that his government is to request the issuance of a UN resolution confirming the protection of the two-state solution, stressing on the need to request full membership of the State of Palestine in the United Nations.
We reject today with all our will and strength the most racist and extremist plans of Israeli government that target Al-Aqsa Mosque and all our holy sites. And we cannot forget in this context the crime of burning Al-Aqsa Mosque. We have been exposed in the past and we are still being subjected to the biggest falsification of our history. They said when a plot to occupy the state of Palestine began that it was a land without a people for a people without land. Was Palestine, as they claim, a land without a people, as they claim, so that those would come to occupy it under these allegations? And in the face of the Israeli intransigence and its practices that crossed all red lines, we will go in the next few days to the United Nations and the Security Council, Human Rights, and the League of Nations. And if the resolution is not implemented, then we go to the United Nations, including the Security Council, to demand a resolution that confirms the protection of the two-state solution.
Foreign For his part, Secretary General of the Arab League, Mr. Ahmed Abul Ghait, stated that Al-Quds is a city under occupation by the reality of international law, and its historical status cannot be changed by unilateral measures from the right-wing Zionist government.
إننا ومن خلال هذا المؤتمر نخاطب العالم كله ونسمعه صوتنا القدس.
We through this conference address the whole world. Al-Quds is a city under occupation according to the international law. There is no room for controversy about this, and its historical status or its international legal status cannot be changed by unilateral measures or political displays that have no goal other than internal gains pursued by members of the right-wing extremist government aiming to score points with their voters.
The Algerian Minister of Foreign Affairs and National Community Abroad, Mr. Mtallah Mamra, held talks with the Secretary General of the Arab League, Abul Ghait, on Sunday. The bilateral talks focused on the implementation of resolutions of the Arab Summit held in Algeria on the 1st and 2nd of November, which focused on the Palestinian cause, according to a statement issued by the Algerian Foreign Affairs Ministry. Mr. Lamamra also met with many of his Arab counterparts on the sidelines of his participation in the conference to support occupied Palestine. To a different news now, the Algerian news agency website Algérie Presse Service, aka APS, or APS in English, in its multilingual versions, has been the subject since Sunday of a severe series of cyber attacks with the name of its hacking. Hence, it's temporarily blocked as a preventive measure to protect its database. These severe attacks have been localized and come from Morocco, the occupying Zionist entity, and some parts of Europe. The agency's technical measures and systems repel these severe cyber attacks, which are still ongoing. The website has for some time been subjected to other cyber attacks in the context of the media and cyber war targeting our country for its crucial positions and decisions, in particular those taken by the state in respect of its immutable principles towards national, regional, and international causes, positions, and principles conveyed and publicized by the APS. The Palestinian Health Ministry announced the death of a 14-year-old Kosai Radwan during the occupation forces' storming of the Jbiriyat neighborhood in the city of Jenin, near the camp. Zionist forces also arrested the freed prisoner Jibril Az-Zubaydi, as armed confrontations and clashes between resistance fighters and forces of the Zionist occupation broke out, which led to serious injury of three Palestinians, one of whom was a child, Waqid. In a separate matter, the occupation forces launched since the early hours of the morning a large-scale campaign of raids in a number of occupied Al-Quds towns and neighborhoods. To Turkey, Syria, earthquakes now. About 35,000 people have been reported dead due to the deadly earthquake that hit southern Turkey and northern Syria. Algerian authorities conducted a new wave of aid for the Syrian people, while Algerian rescue teams continue their efforts to find more potential survivors. More details in this report by Usama Ayadi.
About 35,000 people have been counted dead so far since the devastating earthquake hit Turkey and Syria. People are still hoping for new survivors as rescue operations are reaching the end in the next 2 days maximum.
It's heartbreaking, the damage and the impact on the people. And we have just come today with some supplies and look forward to continue to support.
Like many countries who rushed to the affected areas, Algeria is now conducting a second wave of aid towards Syria. Algerian authorities sent a new humanitarian aid to Syria via three military cargo planes, including 70 tons of medicines and medical supplies for emergency services, water, and foodstuffs. The new batch, which was sent in line with the instructions of the Algerian President Abdelmadjid Tebboune, was supervised by the Algerian Red Crescent in coordination with the Syrian authorities and the Syrian Red Crescent.
The process of sending aid comes within the framework of Algeria's solidarity with the broadly Syrian people following the ordeal of the earthquake.
Algerian Red Crescent crews, along with rescue teams, continued the relief efforts. Algerian civil defense personnel have been hailed by the Washington Post newspaper for the enormous efforts that they are delivering in order to relieve people in the affected area.
Syrian authorities have begun to demolish buildings damaged by the earthquake that struck northern cities in the country, indicating a partial suspension of rescue and search efforts for finding survivors. Meanwhile, the Border Crossing Office of Bab al-Hawa has announced that a second convoy of United Nations assistance entered Syria on the seventh day of the earthquake, adding that the caravan is made up of 10 trucks transporting aids for those affected.
The General Secretariat formed the Public Safety Committee to uncover the fragile buildings. Until now, we have evacuated 80% of the residents of the area. We are now demolishing these buildings in order to protect the citizens.
And now away from the file of Turkey-Syria earthquake and to Africa. According to a statement by the Algerian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Algeria strongly condemned the terrorist attack on a Nigerian army group during its patrol in a town southeast Niger at the Malian border. Algeria expressed its sincere condolences to the government and the families of the victims and wishes them a prompt recovery for all the injured. The statement added that Algeria backs Niger in its fight against terrorism, reiterating its support for further action against terrorism at the regional and international levels. The recent measures implemented at the orders of the Algerian President, Mr. Abdelmadjid Tebboune, who called for the Tunisians to be taken care of at the Algerian border crossing posts, helped increase the flexibility of movement between the two countries. Tunisian travelers appreciated the move and felt satisfied with the facilities and the good Algerian hospitality.
Algerians are very generous. One of them said, "If you don't have money to buy food or pay gas, I'm here to help."
To neighboring Libya now, the head of the Libyan Presidential Council, Mohamed El-Menfi, stressed the need to complete consensual electoral laws before the end of next April in order to conduct the electoral process by the end of 2023. This came in a tweet written by El-Menfi through his official Twitter account during a visit to the city of Benghazi.
Achieving national and international consensus is necessary for conducting the electoral process before the end of the year 2023, which requires the correct and transparent implementation of consensual electoral laws before the end of next April or the implementation of legislation in force.
To Russia-Ukraine file now, after Slovakia has agreed to send 11 MiG fighters to Ukraine to expand its existing fleet. Here's the Polish President Andrzej Duda on a pre-recorded BBC interview saying that giving F-16 fighter jets to Ukraine would require a consensus between Western allies. More details in the story of Sofian Kanturi.
Outside Poland.
In a BBC pre-recorded interview aired on Sunday, Polish President Andrzej Duda said on Wednesday that giving F-16 fighter jets to Ukraine is a decision that would require a consensus among allies. Duda confirmed that Poland has very few F-16 jets, which makes it difficult for Poland to give them away to Ukraine.
We think that this requires a decision by the Allies anyway, which means that we have to make a joint decision. Also, due to the fact that there is a very serious need for maintenance of F-16s if they were to be deployed somewhere, it is not only about the jets. You also need maintenance and technical background, technical servicing, and so on and so forth.
The Polish Prime Minister made a public statement before the airing of the interview, in which he highlighted that any decision on supplying fighter jets to Ukraine must come from NATO.
The debate on fighter jets, which today is at most just beginning, would have to be a decision on the part of NATO, and Poland would decide on our side what to do if there is such a unanimous decision, on the part of NATO that fighter jets would be transferred to Ukraine.
For his part, UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres underlined that the chances for peace keep fading and warned that the world is walking into a wider war over Ukraine with severe repercussions.
The prospects for peace keep diminishing. The chances of further escalation and bloodshed keep growing. I fear the world is not sleepwalking into a wider war. I fear it's doing so with its eyes wide open.
Indeed, most of Western countries that have provided Ukraine with arms before are now at odds over sending fighter jets on long-range weapons, capable of striking deep inside Russia, as it would be a serious escalation of the war that could have irreversible effects on the whole world.
To other news in Europe now. Berliners returned to polls on Sunday, choosing a government for the city-state for the second time in 18 months, after a court ruled the election invalid because of irregularities. The vote could turf left-wing mayor Francesca Giffey out of office well before the end of her term and complicate life for the federal chancellor, her party ally Olaf Scholz, by depriving his coalition of more votes in the upper house of parliament.
I hope that we will soon have clarity as to how things will work out. But for us, it is quite clear that the SPD would like to remain the leading force in this city. We have started to ensure that the city hall remains red, and we want to do everything we can to make the political majorities possible.
Hundreds of thousands of supporters of public health gathered in central Madrid on Sunday to demand better working conditions and to protect public health system from the conservative regional government destruction, as they put it. Madrid government has been the target of criticism, especially since COVID-19 pandemic started in 2020, over poor staffing in hospitals and primary healthcare centers. Protesters say it is dismantling public health services and favoring private health providers instead.
Well, our situation is getting worse. As we have fewer resources and less staff, we believe that everything that is being done is in favor of private health and it's a business. We think we have to fight against this and defend the public health, as it's what makes us all equal.
To Latin America now, hundreds lined the streets with signs calling for Peruvian President Dina Boluarte's waving banner and chanting slogans. Security officers dispersed the protesters in an attempt to maintain control over Lima's historic center, an area where Lima's Metropolitan Council has decreed a ban for at least 180 days on all public gatherings that threaten public safety or health. More details with Selma Nasib.
Thousands of protesters in Peru descended on Lima on Saturday, demanding the resignation of Peruvian President Dina Boluarte and a new constitution. The protests erupted violent clashes with security forces who fired tear gas to try to disperse the protesters.
We're marching peacefully, but what the police are doing is dividing us, throwing tear gas at us, because they want to make it seem as if we're not together and united. We are simply demonstrating peacefully.
Earlier on Friday, President Dina Boluarte, in attempt to calm the streets, called for dialogue and said in news conference that Peru's democracy is currently the most fragile in Latin America. She also asked Congress to bring elections forward.
I call the Congress of the Republic in its role of the state's main power. Let's be responsible towards what people and the streets demand and lay out again the elections overtake. I think our democracy in Peru is the most fragile in Latin America, but here there are Peruvians and us to strengthen our democracy.
However, on the ground, protesters seem to have a different opinion. They're seeking immediate elections and the resignation of President Dina Boluarte if she really wants peace.
Many will say that Dina Boluarte's resignation solves nothing, but her resignation shows that you can't stay in power as if nothing happened, that you have to resign in order to have a minimum desire to make peace with the people and justice.
Among the other demands of the Peruvian streets are the release of President Pedro Castillo ousted and arrested for trying to dissolve Congress in December, and justice for protesters killed in clashes with police.
In Latin America still, Mexican President Andrés Manuel López Obrador declared on Saturday that his country, quote, will lead a more active movement uniting every nation to defend the sovereignty of Cuba, end quote. The statement was made during the island's president's visit to Mexico. With the statement, the Mexican president reiterated his condemnation of the U.S. blockade of Cuba, which he deemed inhumane.
Since we received the invitation from our dear friend President Andrés Manuel López Obrador, it has been our interest to hold this meeting with you to share our appreciation for the laudable work you have done in these months.
An American political scientist believes that China and the United States are in a new Cold War, which has been fueled by the U.S. attempt to contain China's development in the field of cutting-edge technology. Professor John Mearsheimer, an international relations scholar from the University of Chicago, examined the U.S. President Joe Biden's promise of no new war, or no new Cold War, I'm saying, with China. He noted that the Cold War mindset of U.S. will continue to be reflected in its global competition with China, far technological dominance, with more attempts to hobble technology-related trade between Europe and China. In related news, more unidentified objects were spotted flying over North America and another one in China. Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau said Sunday that, on his order, a U.S. fighter jet shot down an unidentified object that was flying high over Yukon after the U.S. shot down another flying object over Alaska. More with Islam Sid in this report.
North America seems to be on a high alert after another unknown object was shot down by U.S. fighter jet, spotted over Canada on Saturday. U.S. officials detected two other flying objects at a high altitude on Friday evening and Sunday afternoon and ordered to shoot them down.
Yesterday, NORAD confirmed that an unidentified object entered unlawfully Canadian airspace. It represented a reasonable threat to civilian aircraft, so I gave the order to take it down.
Canada was tracking a high-altitude object over central Yukon. North American Aerospace Defense Command detected this object and launched Canadian and U.S. fighter aircraft to investigate.
It is the second shootdown in 2 days, which raised many questions over the essence of these flying objects. However, U.S. national security officials believe they were balloons.
Until they get that comprehensive analysis, however, we have to look at each balloon individually
and see what this stunt. Were these balloons Friday and Saturday night?
They believe they were, yes.
According to Chinese state media, Chinese authorities spotted another unidentified flying object over Shandong province, and they were preparing to shoot it down. But it's still unclear who the flying object might belong to.
Local maritime authorities in East China's Shandong province announced on Sunday that they had spotted an unidentified flying object in waters near the coastal city of Rijiao in the province and were preparing to shoot it down, reminding fishermen to be safe via messages.
The U.S. spotted a balloon over its lands, then it downed it on February 4th. It claimed that the balloon belongs to China and accused it with espionage on its military sites. The incident grabbed the world's attention and sparked tensions between the two world powers, as every country is now looking to the skies with more skepticism.
And for more news making headlines around the globe, here's the news in brief by Zahra Frigeni this time.
6 migrants died when trying to reach the Canary Islands, according to the 23 survivors of this dangerous journey, who reached the island of Tenerife on Sunday early morning after being stranded on a dinghy for 9 days. An operation by Brazilian authorities succeeded in destroying an illegal mining area in Yanomami indigenous territory on Saturday. The area had been discovered the day before during a flyover by agents of the operation coordinated by many Brazilian ministries and institutions. Residents of New Zealand's biggest city were urged on Sunday to prepare for the impact of a storm that buffered Australia's Norfolk Island overnight. The Australian Outpost's Emergency Management Authority said Gabrielle downgraded to a subtropical low-pressure system from a Category 2 cyclone, passed over Norfolk Island, its most destructive winds missing the island. Cyprus holds a tightly fought presidential election on Sunday between two diplomats, each seeking to persuade undecided voters that he is the best choice to govern the European Union member. The winner needs 50% plus one vote to succeed the current two-term president as the Mediterranean Island Republic's eighth president.
That will be the end of our program. For more news, you can always check our social media platforms as well as our website, as you can see below on our screen. Well, that's it. Thank you for tuning in, and bye for now.